Greetings, South Africa, and welcome to Your World this 20th day of July. Now, in remarks about ending violence against children by 2030, UN Secretary General Antonio Guterres said, and I quote, "Violence against children is a silent emergency that must end." End of quote. Now, in Kenya, the 2019 Violence Against Children survey released last week indicates that half of our children suffer some form of violence. We are talking about physical, sexual, or emotional abuse. Today, we shed light on where or how we are failing our children, and experts will help us discuss how we can end the vicious cycle of violence against children. My name is Gladys Gachanja, and this is What Else You Can Expect on this broadcast.
Sexually assaulted by a team leader at my job.
A young Nairobi woman narrates how it began with subtle but alarming suggestions and ended up in court. Mongolia held its national sports festival behind closed doors for the first time due to the pandemic.
About a third of children say they experienced emotional violence by peers in the past 12 months.
As I mentioned, half of Kenyan children suffer from violence. Where are we going wrong? We answer this and other questions on this broadcast.
The 13-year-old is 6 months pregnant, a product of a sexual crime committed against her by her own flesh and blood.
Kisumu girls bear the extra shame of walking around with the growing evidence of their own father's sins. As I mentioned, today we focus on our children, and the question of the day to you is, how best can we protect children from violence? We're talking about sexual, physical, or even emotional abuse. How can we protect our children? Well, remember that hashtag new normal on our social media handles, and you can also call in or text us using that number at the bottom of your screen. And this morning, as always on Your World, we give you an update of the numbers in as far as the effects of COVID-19 globally look like, and those numbers stand at 14,644,360 people confirmed to have COVID-19. Now, 8,735,298 people have totally recovered from the same. And unfortunately, that number of those that have succumbed to the disease is at 608,911 globally. Now, a look at our country, Kenya. And the confirmed cases this far stand at 13,353. Thankfully, 5,122 people have recovered from COVID-19. And unfortunately, we've lost 234 Kenyans to COVID-19. Those numbers keep changing per the hour, and we shall be keeping you updated as and when we receive those numbers. Now, a look at how this virus is impacting the world, and Morocco announces a return to lockdown measures in the northern port city of Tangiers to smother a new outbreak of the novel coronavirus weeks after easing nationwide restrictions. Now, the city of about 1 million inhabitants was locked down, with public transport suspended, cafes and public spaces closed, and movement restricted. Residents are only allowed to leave their homes in cases of extreme necessity, According to the Interior Ministry, authorities decided to reimpose the measures to prevent the spread of the virus after new infection clusters. The northern city within sight of the Spanish coast on a clear day has a vast port and is a key economic hub linking Africa with Europe and beyond. Back home in the heart of the majestic plains of Kenya's Masai Mara, the coronavirus pandemic is wreaking economic havoc. The Masai community, highly dependent on tourism, has seen its livelihood reduced to almost nothing, with the women and children most affected.
The most unfortunate people in this COVID-19 is the children and the women, simply because the men usually go for the works, and the 100% they are getting is come back to home. And even the ladies of themselves, like the mom, midwife ladies, usually come to work. So at the moment, no work is done. And even you see the children, they usually go to school. Most of them are in the boarding school. They get lunch there, they get educated, they get everything. But at the moment, they are at home, lacking all the education, plus even the food they are currently getting at the school.
And to focus us on the conversation of the day, unwanted and attempted sex and physical violence among teenage girls and boys have been releasing sharply, or rather increasing sharply within the last decade. Now, this is according to a report on violence against children released the last week by the Ministry of Social Protection and Labour in conjunction with UNICEF. Now, the survey also reveals that many children think violence is to be tolerated and believe it is acceptable for a husband to beat his wife. Eunice Omolo was at the launch.
Unwanted and attempted sex among girls aged between 13 to 17 has increased from 3.3% in 2010 to 8.5% in 2019. Similarly, the number of teenage girls who reported physical violence doubled from 17.8% to 36.8% in the last decade.
Violence is specifically associated with increased risk of sexual transmitted diseases and infections, including HIV.
Physical violence is the most common form of violence against children, affecting nearly 2 out of 5 females and half of males. This is mostly perpetrated by parents and caregivers.
Violence against children is a silent emergency that must end. If we want just, cohesive, and peaceful societies, we must tackle the violence that threatens children's lives and compromises the enjoyment of their rights.
About a third of children say they experienced emotional violence by peers in the past 12 months. These include bullying.
Spot it, stop it. It's a national End Violence Against Children campaign, and the clear message of call to action: whenever violence happens, it should be reported. So even among the peers need to know.
1 in 2 young adults aged between 18 and 24 was physically abused while growing up, whereas nearly 1 in 6 men and 1 in 15 men reported experiencing sexual violence as a child.
Yes, thank you.
The report also says half the males and females interviewed had witnessed violence at home before the age of 18, while 1/3 of females and half of males witnessed violence in the community before the same age.
High tolerance of violence in the country, at homes, in schools and community at large, has led to the exposure of children to more violent environment. And as a result, this affects their behavior emotionally and physically in future, and probability of them being violent beings.
The survey spoke to more than 2,000 children and young adults from all 47 counties in Kenya between December 2018 and January 2019. Eunice Omolo, NTV, Nairobi.
So our conversation this morning focuses on ending violence against children. To help us have this conversation in studio with me is Wawira Nyaga, and she is the National Coordinator for the East Africa Civil Society Organizations Forum. We're also joined by Anne Gunjiri, who is a Senior Technical Advisor, GBV, at the LVCT Health, and of course, Roselyn Motemi Wangahu, who is a Communication for Development Specialist at UNICEF Kenya, who is joining us virtually. And also joining us virtually, we have Lois Noh, who is a counseling psychologist. Ladies, thank you for joining me, and we shall also be joined by other panelists even as we try break down reasons why we're seeing such huge numbers in as far as the children who have been affected by violence and how we can actually end this vicious cycle. And I'll start off with you, Wawira. When you think about violence, I think it is important for all of us to define what violence is in the first place. Mm-hmm. What is it?
When you look at violence, just by its name, it's a forceful, intentional type of physical or emotional, mm-hmm. or any sort of intentional force that mm-hmm. has been used that can cause harm or injury. Just looking at it from a layman's language, what violence is, and just saying how it will cause harm or injury. Mm-hmm. And when you go down and deeper to child violence, of course, it's any sort of violence that affects, protection of children's rights, or mm-hmm. Children being in an enabling environment for them to just do their day-to-day and them growing in a manner that you would expect that the children grew. So mm-hmm. just looking at it from that layman's language, violence is intentional, mm-hmm. it causes harm, and it causes a lot of injury.
Okay, now Anne, you were smack in the middle of putting together this survey. Can a violence be unintentional? Okay, we shall get to her, but let me bring in Lois into this conversation, or rather Roselyn into this conversation. Roselyn, is it possible to actually be unintentional when it comes to violence against children?
Good morning, viewers, and good morning, Gladys. Yes, violence can happen without intentions. Many parents, like you've seen in this survey report, are violated children. A lot of them think that it's part of socialization process. It happened to them when they were children themselves, and they continue, for example, in the guise of their providing discipline to their children.
Mm-hmm. Okay, and when you were doing the survey, what was coming out? Is it more intentional or is it more unintentional?
Gladys, let me say from the survey, it's both. Mm-hmm. And I'll say both because we have intentional violence, even though the survey scope was not really to measure violence that is intentional or non-intentional. Mm-hmm. And in any case, violence is an abuse of rights for children.
Okay, and Lois, maybe you can explain to us from a counseling psychologist point of view, whether intentional or unintentional, how does a child receive this kind of, violence of whatever sort?
Thank you. Thank you so much. I think whether intentional or unintentional, violence is meted against a child. One of the things that we know and we have now proved clearly is that anyone who is a caregiver to a child presents a world of reality and a world of interaction for them. And sometimes I do say, like, any caregiver represents the whole reality of humanity to a child. So when that person becomes violent, then this child's world of reality is distorted. And then they begin to get confused and wonder, how then is reality, or does it mean the world is that violent? Mm-hmm. And then it begins to define what the world is for them and start giving them the kind of interaction that they will have when they are adults themselves or when they have control of their world.
Okay, and do we have Anne Gunjiri? Because I'd like to pose this question to her. Anne, we saw that around 1 in 2 young adults in Kenya actually experience violence as a child out of that survey, which is a huge number. Is this by any chance an indication of how, as a society, we perceive violence or perceive children in the first place?
Yes, the numbers are, as you've quoted there, 1 in 2 children, which is not very different from what we're seeing globally as well. So Kenya is falling on that trend, unfortunately. And it is the saddest thing because our children and our adolescents, they're the most vulnerable. They're the ones who cannot defend themselves. And for them to go through this, whether intentional or unintentional, is a sad affair. And I think it also reflects back on us as a society. Right now, there's a lot of stories in the media where there seems to be a shift in victim blaming the survivor. The question of whether it is intentional or unintentional, to the survivor's eyes, to the child and to the adolescent, they're seeing it as them going through an experience of either physical force, threats, coercion, that they certainly do not deserve for whatever reason they might have posed out there perhaps. So I think the reflection of 1 in 2 is I'd like to throw it back to the community. It's how we are handling children. Are we giving them a voice? Are we communicating with them as we should? Or is it a matter of just because we realize they cannot defend themselves, they do not have a voice because of perhaps our African culture, we are doing the things that we are doing to them as a community? So these numbers do actually reflect on how it is we live in our society. We need to reflect on whether there are things that perpetuate violence amongst us, like our cultural norms, or whether we've normalized it so much that we think it's okay to inflict whatever form of violence on our children without thinking of the repercussions, as they've been rightly said, on the child themselves. So it's a reflection of us as our society and how it is that we treat our children and our adolescents.
Okay, now let me bring in Anna Mwenesi, who is a sign language interpreter for us. She will be interpreting for Joy Kanana, who is the Deaf Outreach Officer at the Deaf Empowerment Society of Kenya, and she is joining us from Embu. And the question to Joy is, when they talk about such huge numbers of children affected by violence, is this something that you actually relate to, especially for children with special needs? Okay, unfortunately, when we come back, we will sort out Joy's voice because we cannot hear what Anna is saying, but we shall sort that out as soon as we can. But let me come back to studio. And when we think about the numbers on this survey, half of young women and young men between the ages of 18 and 24 actually witnessed violence at home as a child. What pitfalls are these in the home that these children actually look at or see that reflect back as violence?
Let's start first by what pitfalls are in the house, mm-hmm, that cause violence. Okay. And through the pitfalls that cause violence, they get to see it. Let's talk about drug abuse and parents who are abusive because of coming home, the parent is drunk and causes physical abuse, mm-hmm, or even just emotional abuse through the words that they use. Mm-hmm. And you could see even in the survey that some children could see that they could, hear words that are a bit abusive. Mm-hmm. And sometimes, probably, an example, if a child tries to intervene, mm-hmm, in like a physical violence, mm-hmm, they'll also receive the same emotional abuse that's being translated to the other partner, be it male or female, mm-hmm, and it translates to them. So when looking at some of the underlying factors that cause the violence at home, mm-hmm, moving away from drug violence, drug abuse, and coming to the economic factors, for example. Like right now during COVID, the food insecurity, which was also before COVID, there was a lot of socioeconomic factors that could cause violence, lack of unemployment, the dominance factor between two partners, be it male or female, because, you know, violence can happen to either male or female. So there's such underlying factors that cause such violence. Mm-hmm. And from a child, looking at it from the point of, and I think my colleagues have mentioned the same thing, that cycle of looking at this happening, if it's happening because of socioeconomic factors or because of dominance, and if it's violence between someone feeling like the other person is not doing what they're supposed to do, mm-hmm. looking at the societal norms, the expectations of what women are supposed to do or men are supposed to do, and the child looking at it and wondering, is this what's supposed to happen? So if this is the cause of violence, then maybe this is not supposed to happen, or maybe this is supposed to happen, and it brings all the confusion to the children. Mm-hmm. And that is why our homes need to be the first safe space, because, I mean, if they move from the house and it's not safe, and go to schools where there are also places where violence is experienced, yeah. such as bullying or even sexual abuse from the people that are supposed to take care of them. So it all begins with, what are these factors that are causing the violence, and also what they're seeing? Because that whole cycle from what's the cause, what's happening, what are they seeing, reflecting to how they become mm-hmm. and how they perceive violence.
Okay. And Roseline, at this point, when we talk about the intentional versus the unintentional, when a child is watching their parents go at each other and not necessarily even being the recipient of the violence, are we saying that this still would have an impact?
Definitely. When a child grows up witnessing violence, they begin to normalize. They begin to feel that this is the way things are done. Mm-hmm. And so if you watch closely, you realize that children that come from violent homes, even when they interact with other children, they are also violent. Because that's the way they see their world. Their world, it's all about violence. If there's an issue, they begin to believe that the only solution to sorting any differences is through violence, which of course they'll have picked from watching their parents or caregivers or violent happening at home.
Mm-hmm. And for you, Anne, you said in the survey, and you were part of this survey, is that when these children are watching this and at some point they become the recipient of this violence, they start either becoming the person they watch or they totally regress from that. What have you seen and what was coming out of the survey?
Hey, one of the things about violence from a perspective of behavior, children learn more from what they see. Their behavior is modeled by adults. So the children who have watched violence,
seeing violence directly, you'd either find that they were either victims in their adulthood, or some of them, unfortunately, were condoning violence happening in the relationships that they're in. We call that the intergenerational cycle of violence, where what you experience and what you go through as a child will have effects on you, immediate effects on you as a child, which have rightly been mentioned, the mental issues that they might have, the physical injuries and whatnot. But then in their adulthood, they still tend to exhibit some of the symptoms or consequences that we wouldn't have thought of. So we're talking about suicide ideation. Some of those who say that they had suicidal thoughts, some of those who say that they were smoking for over 30 days continuously and having such excessive habits, those who were perhaps in their taking sexual risk behaviors, increased numbers of unprotected sex, or not using protection, you could actually relate this to the experience of any of the three forms of violence in their childhood. So the consequences is not just in the childhood, it certainly spreads through into their adulthood, and that intergenerational effect is because of them going through violence in their household, or even witness either directly or witnessing what their parents or caregivers are doing, or in the community, or violence inflicted of them as by their peers, either in schools or any other setting that their child might be in.
Okay, and Lois, maybe you can explain to us that vicious cycle that if I watch it, I become it, or at times I do not want to be anywhere near that person, or I get attracted to people that acted as I watched when growing up.
Thank you. I think adding to just what has been said, I think the greatest tragedy that can happen to a young child in their formative years is to, in fact, listen or witness violence, especially on the person that they hold as the most important person, the significant, particularly if it's a caregiver, the mother, the father. That's, to me and to us as psychologists, is the greatest tragedy, because then what happens is that the issue, the violence, or the normalizing, as someone has put it, is brought in. The child is wired to grow up, and they are really confused when in their next world, they basically see that that is not even acceptable, or they cannot be violent just the way they have seen it happening. Then what happens to that child at that particular point then is they begin to be confused. And particularly, I'm saying this having worked as a teacher of transitional, young adults for over a decade before I got into full-time psychology, that many of them now come into a school environment where this is not condoned and structures are put and punishments are meted out, then they begin to really feel like they don't even deserve to leave. And that's what my other colleague said. They then think that I may just need to die. Because if I cannot do what I was meant to know, that is a normal thing, then I don't even deserve to be in this environment. And so it becomes a vicious cycle. And then when they are able now to control their world, meaning that they are now adults, then either most of them would then become very violent, or they do everything that is violent, or they completely do not want to touch anybody, be violent with anyone, and they actually lose even the ability to interact healthily and even, just be able to conflict resolution skills. They completely lack them.
Okay, and it is interesting that you bring that up, because according to the survey, physical violence was the most common type of violence, mostly perpetrated by parents and caregivers. And I'm wondering, Wawire, this is the point where there's been a lot of discussions and discourse about corporal punishment. We know right here in the country that was banned back in 2001, but this is the reality of parenting in this country. How does that have an impact on a child?
Yeah, I think that's a topic that we normally have, especially as parents, and also looking at the social norms and the fact that it was banned in school. And, the children are aware that a parent is not supposed to beat me. Mm-hmm. My teacher is not supposed to beat me. And when the child comes home and reports that the teacher beat them, the parent will think about how it was banned, and we'll think about how it is a bad thing that affects the child. But then when it comes down to the house, or if the caregiver also hits a child, it's the same thing. The parent is going to react and possibly tell the caregiver not to ever do it again. Mm-hmm. But then what happens when it is us, the parents, that are doing it? How does that affect the child? How do they think? Do they look at it as double standards, or do they look at it as it's something that the parents are supposed to do? So it is a conflicting situation, because at times when you have the discussions with possibly our parents, our grandparents, people who have been there before, parents, and they look at it
as it's something that's supposed to happen to discipline the child so that they can, you can stop them from doing some of the things. But we are saying don't hit them. Advise them. Use the, these days the good thing is that most of the people that do the counseling or training on parenting, at least there's so many classes on that, and they're training on how to use to stop doing what was previously normalized and start using the other ways that are, can possibly be used. For example, not saying, you know, hitting them and saying, no, don't do that, do this instead, or can you try doing this this other way, you know? And it is still a discussion that needs to be had. Possibly counselors can keep on telling us how to go about it, because as parents, most of them feel like, this is my child. If I don't hit them, how are they going to stop?
Okay, and before we get to the psychologist, let me pose this to Roslyn. We grew up, and this is all we knew how to do, being thumped by your parent to a point where you felt like you're going to die. And some would say, I turned out just fine. So where do you draw the line, Rosalie?
I think there was the history, Gladys, and thank you very much for your question, how we've been raised. And that, like I say, it's, it forms socialization. And so as we moved on, we know for sure there are better ways of disciplining a child. We came out well by the grace of God, because that's really, I wouldn't say that was the best way of really getting or pushing a point or making a child know exactly what is expected of them. There are better ways of doing the same, which is, we're saying it's positive disciplining, where a parent can engage with a child. And when a child makes a mistake, because children will always make mistakes, they are children, they are growing, they require guidance. There are better ways of guiding a child or correcting a mistake from a child, not necessarily resorting to violence.
Okay, and Anne, when you did this survey, what were the children saying? When does it become too much from the parents?
As the results showed, physical violence was one of the highest forms of violence that they experienced. More than half their children had experienced it. When asked for the reasons why, some of them felt like they deserved it. Certainly for what they did, they felt like their parent beating them was a corrective measure that they tolerated. And that again reflects back on our society. I think when you're looking at things related, matters related to corporal punishment, we need to look at the bigger picture. It's not just about the individual and them feeling like they deserved it. Normally with any form of violence, there's what you call the socio-ecological model. And it's not just about the individual or the relationship of the family setup. It goes beyond that. It goes to the community level. It goes to the policy level. So in terms of what the children were saying was that, yes, they deserved that form of violence for the mistakes that they did. And the parents, when you ask them in retrospect, is that that is the only way they know of how to discipline the child. Now we need to look, if that was one of the cause types of violence that we want to address, we need to look at the individual and the family relationships, as has been rightly mentioned, the positive parenting skills, which is not a norm that we are used to in our African setup, but certainly advisable for us to take it up. But we need to look at the society. Is physical violence or corporal punishment towards our children one of those things that we've accepted that is the only way to handle it? And that norms needs to change. As you said, the corporal punishment or physical violence was indeed banned in Kenya. What are we doing at implementation of these laws and policies? So as much as we want to bring it down to addressing the relationships between the child, whether they think it's a normal form of violence or whether they accept it, and the parent in terms of their parenting skills, we need to look at it from a bigger picture and also see what are we doing for those ones who are indeed guilty of inflicting corporal punishment on their children. Is the law taking its course? What are we doing at community level? Are we doing enough mobilization at community in community awareness to educate people and tell them, you do not have to pick up that cane and beat your child. There are other alternatives with better consequences on their life or this child rather than reaching out and lashing to them. And we also need to tell the child, if you do go through this, you can speak out. You can actually alert authorities and let it be known that this is what you're going through at home, because the home is supposed to be the safest place for a child. And for sure, physical violence is not something that they should be experiencing, where they should feel most at safe.
Okay, when we come back from a short break, Lois Noor, you need to help us out here. They say, spare the rod, spoil the child. I know you have a religious background. You will let us know how we can actually balance the two, if at all. Stay with us.
Change can be disruptive, but Business Daily has got you covered from Monday to Friday. Get evolving trends, ingenious business ideas, and the latest tech content in the new market dynamic, and exciting lifestyle content in the new normal environment. Business Daily, more possibilities.
Koroho yako naona umesmile uko poa.
Yaani 3 weeks tumekuwa tukicheka na ulijiwekea koroho yako, sasa ndio unaniambia saa hii.
Budako, I'm sure anaweza get watu hata, in fact, watu wazee kabisa.
Ndaongea na babangu basi.
Niko na jambo. Inanisumbua kwa roho. Na nimeshindwa nitaambia nani? Nini inakusumbua?
Nikichelewa tu kidogo hivi simu. Nisipochukua kama niko meeting pahali. Ni issue. Nikiwa na maboys nimeenda pahali mimi tu tumeenda ka meeting. Karibu aniulize niko wapi nikuje. Unanielewa?
Sisi tumekuja ili hii ndoa yako
Enjoy the naturally appealing taste of our unique fruit blend. Represent who you naturally are with Juice Juice Drink. Naturally ours with no added preservatives. A quality product from Bidco Africa.
Send your parcel or document during this period, the Nation Courier Services with over 15 years of distribution experience will deliver it for you. We deliver to every corner of Kenya due to our strong distribution network. Have overnight door-to-door service and same-day intra-city service with the security and safety of the client's shipment guaranteed. Your parcel is our priority. We'll deliver it for you. Contact us for delivery on couriersservices@ke.nationmedia.com or call 0719-038-739.
Along came love.
There has been a tragedy, sweetheart. What happened?
You repay me by taking the love of my life away from me? There's no point in being a good man in this life.
They are good people. They really didn't deserve this.
You don't exist! You don't exist!
However hard you try to deny it, I know it was you.
Along came love.
Along came love. In association with Blue Band Peanut Butter.
Hey, as a professor, out of analytical observation, I have realized that there are three types of coughing. Kukohoa, kuna wale wa... Huo ni mtu wako na pesa. Account is loaded. Kuna hawa wa...
To get this Kiza tune, dial *811*848# for Professor.
Thank you.
It is Your World. My name is Gladys Gachanja. We're still talking about how to end violence against children. And before we went to break, we were talking about physical violence rating as the most common amongst children and corporal punishment, especially from parents and caregivers, ranking highest. And before we hear from the psychologist, I'd like to hear from Joy Kanana again. She joins us. She's the Deaf Outreach Officer at Deaf Empowerment Society of Kenya. Hi, interpreter is Anna Monesi, and I'd like to know from you, Joy, when you talk about corporal punishment, how is that received, especially for the children with special needs?
Well, I agree. I've seen it, the corporal punishment in schools, and most of the teachers, if the children with special needs do some little mistake, maybe they are beaten and they have a problem with their hand, they are beaten thoroughly, inflicting a lot of pains to the children. So that is physical violence. It brings a lot of physical violence to them. So maybe, for example, the fathers, when they are working at home and maybe the child with special needs did not get and understand what they are supposed to do, they take anything and inflict a lot of pains to these kids. So I see it's very bad to these kids. It's sounding so much, a lot of pain. And maybe sometimes when they go outside to play outside, maybe they don't understand each other among the peers. They start fighting and they cause a lot of wound. And this brings a lot of problems to these children when they are fighting. So maybe, for example, we are talking about domestic violence at home. When the girls are beaten with their husbands, they are given heavily punishment with their husbands. That is violence against the children also.
Now, there are suggestions that we should speak to the child, help them understand how they can correct their behavior. Is it something that they, Joy, thinks it can actually apply for the children with special needs, considering that it is a different dynamic dealing with them?
I think having corporal punishment cannot help the children. To teach the children, you should have positive interaction with the children so that they can understand. So when you beat them and inflict a lot of pains to them, some throw them far away and they get physical problems. And this is a big, it brings a lot of problems to the children with special needs. So you can give them punishment positively and the children possible can understand. So fighting is not the best way, or inflicting a lot of pain to the children is not the best way of punishing the children.
Mm-hmm.
So that is physical challenge. That is very risky to the kids.
Okay, now before I get to Lois, Anne, please clarify, did the survey actually capture the needs of the children with special needs?
I'm sorry, if you could just repeat that again.
Did the survey capture needs of those with special needs?
Unfortunately not. As with every survey, it's restricted by budget, funds and resources. But I do believe that there are organizations that actually collect data on violence amongst those with special needs or people with disabilities. But for this specific one, due to the limitations that we had, the constraints as with any other project, mm-hmm. we did not actually capture this group.
Okay, now to Lois, help us understand how we can toe the line. We're told, discipline your child or else they'll lose their way in life. But then again, if you hit them, you might lose them. Which is which?
Thank you, Anne. I think one of the things, allow me to mention, like you did say, one of the challenge in helping parents to know the line and the limitations is basically just lack of information. And then we are a deeply religious society. And we use the spiritual aspects, and particularly the Christian world, where we always put the entire thing of spare the rod and spoil the child. But then the Christian community forget that there is the background of training, because you're supposed to use the rod after you've trained a child, and maybe they got out of the way of training. Then the other issue that is so evident as we interact, and particularly I do a lot of family therapy, is that we have many parents in who are taking care or who are parenting children who are in their formative years, and particularly the young adults and adolescents are in their 30s or maybe 40s. And most likely, like a few of us have mentioned, they are the ones who experienced that violence when they were being brought up by their own parents. So they know no other way to be able to bring up their children than the socialization that they got. But then sometimes I'm amazed that we never broke a limb or we didn't get head injuries. And yet when you do that now, you are most likely going to have a child who is... Sorry, I'm living near aeroplanes.
Okay.
Sorry about that. Yeah, so I still just wonder, because, and as maybe Roslyn said, it's by the grace of God that we didn't have head injuries or broken our limbs. Mm-hmm. But we are having those parents now with no skills and no training or proper education. And even when it was mentioned, parenting classes are one of the least attended, because we believe as a society that this is something you learn on the job. Mm. And so it's really a challenge, and it's an enormous task to always get parents, and particularly I believe there's places that we can be able to do that and just psychoeducate them on how do you then work with a child of between 0 to 10 years, and what do you do with a child between 10 to 15 years? What works, what interventions helps them to be able to come through to life. Now, something was mentioned about children maybe informing the authorities when they have been violated. That is still something that is way above what we can achieve, because even when this child reports to whichever authority, particularly somebody helps them to go to a police station, you know, they is still taken that a child cannot really come and report a parent. So the child will always be, or the parent will always be told that they sort out the issues with the children. Yet we are finding a person or a child who has been violated, even sexually, by their own caregiver or even by their own parent or an uncle. Then that is the greatest tragedy that we are having at the moment. So where is this child supposed to report?
Yeah. Okay, I hear you, Lois, and allow me to ask this. Could it be that the increasingly sexualized content around us is corrupting our minds and behavior? Well, Anita Konge sought to find out.
Raunchy, to say the least. In a world where access to digital devices is as easy as accessing all manner of alarming sexual content, the effect on human behavior may be manifesting itself in a disturbing sex culture. The Kenya Film Classification Board says a changing media and civilization may be cultivating a disturbing sex culture. But experts say society must reflect on the effect of the paradigm shift.
Older days, when we didn't have exposure to this kind of videos and music, is we didn't normalize sexual activities. But now the messaging is sex is normal.
Sexualized content has been there for decades. And yes, we have more access to sexualized content now, but because it has been around for so long, it doesn't mean that because it's the numbers are high.
Just a month ago, shocking explicit images and videos emerged on social media platform Instagram, showing minors engaging in obscene activities. With that in mind, Julie says change is already here with us, and we must now think of damage control through capacity building.
If we look at the education and the gaps in the education, then we'll see that sexual reproductive health is a huge gap. And as long as that gap remains there, then we're going to have teenage pregnancies, we're going to have incest, we're going to have issues around rape.
Then there's the threat of sex predators lurking online in search of easy prey. A few weeks ago, the Daily Nation published a report on how a female minor was lured into indecent sexual acts through Facebook. The Directorate of Criminal Investigation says the numbers are rising, with 300 cases reported daily at the minimum. Counselors say it is important to understand the psychology of a sex offender if one is to stop them before they pounce.
They have suffered some psychological harm, and so the act is not about the sexual satisfaction. It's about control, it's about power and asserting authority.
They would groom their audience. If it's somebody who's trying to groom a child, then they get into the mind of the child. They get into knowing what kind of things that they enjoy watching, what sort of books, what kind of music, all that kind of grouping.
Tell me and I forget. Show me and I may remember. Involve me and I'll understand. A famous Chinese proverb that may well drive the agenda and conversation towards preventative measures now that the digital disruption is here to stay.
And that is a story that actually points to another type of violence that rates high, sexual violence against children. And Wawera, just looking at that video, would you actually say those are the consequences of what we've exposed our children?
Yes. Mm-hmm. They're part of the consequences, yes.
Mm-hmm.
What we see, what we perceive, just from what we've been talking about since the show started, what you see really matters. How you see other parents reacting to other children's behaviors also matters, because if you have a friend that's posting such photos, mm-hmm. and their parents are aware, and you are the child's friend, mm-hmm. and you see that the parent is not reacting, and you also want to do the same, and then the parent becomes disturbed. So it's a whole cycle. Yeah, it's part of the consequences, I'd say.
Okay, and what was also disturbing out of this survey is that nearly 1 in 6 women and 1 in 15 men said they experienced sexual violence as a child. Mm-hmm. What does that say, and how does that impact to the generation we're seeing now?
Yeah. Yeah, that's true. Sexual violence is on the rise. The percentages are just saddening. Even now, from all the directives we've been getting from the different ministries that are in charge, and even the reactions from both state and non-state actors, it's on the rise. And also allow me to say, like right now, amidst COVID, mm-hmm. As stakeholders, seeing how the cases of violence were on the rise, mm-hmm. we decided to have weekly national GBV meetings, mm-hmm. to enable proper response and coordination. And every week we receive the numbers of the rising cases, which are honestly very, very shocking. Mm-hmm. Is it that there's more reporting, or is it that these cases are actually happening? And it really impacts the child, because look at how many children right now are pregnant. Mm. And some of them are possibly not going to be able to go back to school next yes. year. I don't know if you saw the directive that from the Ministry of Education that was talking about tracking the number yes. of children that have gotten pregnant during this time. And, you know, we are thinking about it as being very positive approach, mm-hmm. but at the same time, how is that also going to, is it going to bring about stigma to the children, them knowing that they might not be able to go there back to school, mm-hmm. they might not be able to join their schoolmates, their schoolmates are going to wonder why the girls didn't come, that mm-hmm. brings about the issue of stigma. I think also, I don't know if it's Anne, she can be able to also explain to us in the survey, as you have mentioned, mm-hmm. you could see that the children that have gone through sexual violence, it has affected their productivity in their future life.
Yeah.
Because you stop going to school, by the time you're catching up with school, something else happens, socioeconomic factors, the stigmatization, all of it just messes up a child.
Mm-hmm. And before I take a short break, Rosaline, I'd like to hear from you. Sexual gender impact, especially when we come to sexual violence, and we've seen the impact of the same as Wawera is talking about. FGM is also one thing that is a thorn in the flesh. What's the impact on this on the children?
Thank you. First of all, let me say all forms of violence on children have long-lasting negative impact on them, a negative impact on the society at large. For escalating numbers of female genital cutting or mutilation, if you like, this one has both emotional impact, negative emotional impact on the child. It also has health impacts in terms of a child who's been cut, that is female genital mutilated, will also have issues to do with pregnancy, negative consequences for pregnancy and childbirth. We have seen in some counties in this country, in Kenya, where female genital cutting is also connected with child marriage.
Yes.
So a child is cut today, and the same day is married off. So when you look at that child, there are no progression in terms of education, because education stops right there. And then they'll go into other consequences that includes the health consequences of child marriage. Sexual violence, FGM, if you like, female genital cutting, emotional violence, all this work together. There's no linear form of violence on a child. A child who experiences sexual violence also experiences emotional violence and also physical violence. So you can see all this violation on children are not linear. They are all connected. Mm-hmm. The children experience all of them together. And in addition, Gladys, allow me to say that children should never be made to feel that violence has occurred as their own fault. It's not their fault that they experience violence. They are violated by people close to them. They are violated by people that they trust. People like parents, sometimes people in authority like teachers, sometimes even the police, and so many other perpetrators who affect children. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I think this is an important point for us to bring to this discussion. Thank you.
Okay, ladies, when we come back, we talk about the impact of violence on children, because as Wawira mentioned, there is a long-lasting impact of violence on children, and we'll touch on that when we come back, so stay with us.
Ukiambiwa 1 plus 2, 10 marks. Wezi andika 3.
Hebu fanya ujinga uvae jeans, t-shirt na kofia. Uingie kwa gari makanga akuitishe feu umwambie nitakupea tukishuka. Unasikianga? Dondoa moja dere.
Wear your mask and maintain social distance always, and sneeze or cough into your elbow. Book your ticket online via iAbiri and use our cashless payment options to play your part to win the COVID-19 war. Ndovu flowers are fortified with vitamins and minerals to provide wholesome goodness for the whole family. Ndovu all-purpose flour makes the most delicious chapatis, mandazis, and all other pastries. Ndovu is readily available at your nearest shop. Ndovu Tosha.
When we moved from analog to digital, we took the opportunity to share our talanta. And the rise of local radio represented our voices mtaani. New ICT and educational platforms are going to make sure that no one is left behind.
Communications Authority of Kenya, opening your world.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you for staying with Your World. My name is Gladys Gachanja. This morning, we are focusing on that 2019 Violence Against Children report survey that was actually released last Thursday. And this was done by the Ministry of Social Protection and Labour in conjunction with UNICEF. And it brought a lot of light to how children are being perceived in society, especially when it comes to violence. And we asked that question to you this morning. How best can we protect children from violence? We're talking about sexual, physical, emotional abuse. And we see your feedback. We start off with McDonald Omondi, who says, actually, they are not supposed to be part of parental fallout. Children are to be treated cautiously, not knowing the ongoing squabbles between parents. Very well said. Ombajo Omari says, I think we need a debate on the merits and demerits of FGM. Is there a reason our forefathers adopted it? Can it help us with this unfortunate tragedy? Good question. Mohammed Shi says, normalize reporting GBV cases to the authority. And this is something that all the stakeholders are hoping this will achieve. Maggie Machogu Yuna says, we cannot talk about violence against children without including female genital mutilation. Call 1195 to report children in danger. Yes, we touched on that, and Rosalind was very, very clear on that. Edward Mundui says, the society is rotten. Even how teachers and police called people, their way of speaking is always cold. Another here from Abdullahi Isaac, who says most of the kids are abused by close family members because they don't have good relations with their own parents. When a child feels their feelings neglected, they usually fall for anyone who feels that void. That actually is the unfortunate truth, and we'll be talking more about the impact of violence against children. And speaking of which, inbreeding is highly frowned upon in many cultures, but some two girls from Kisumu bear the extra shame of walking around with a growing evidence of their own father's sins.
We found Jane, not her real name, at a rescue center here in Kisumu. The 13-year-old is 6 months pregnant, a product of a sexual crime committed against her by her own flesh and blood, her father.
The father is supposed to be arrested. He was supposed to be arrested yesterday, but I think he'll be arrested today.
Jane's father kept her under lock and key for several months, during which he soiled her purity.
Which means the girl would not even get sufficient food, because even when you look at her, she is emaciated. Mm. Yeah, she looks sickly.
Yeah.
Mm.
While such may come as a shock, they are actually rampant out here. Take the case of 15-year-old Anyango, not her real name. Sometimes last year, her own father turned on her.
Akaniita kwa bedroom yake. Sasa mimi sikujua anataka nini. Akaniambia niivue mavazi nipande juu ya kitanda. Nikishapanda ndio akanishika kwa nguvu.
Anyango will discover that a baby was growing inside her 3 months later.
When this case was reported to the Gender-Based Violence Recovery Center, it was confirmed medically that the girl was pregnant. Later on, when the girl was taken to the same center at Jaramogi Oginga Odinga Teaching and Referral Hospital, that pregnancy was not there, which means that this father facilitated abortion.
Attempts to find legal recourse were futile, as this is the case for many victims. Patricia Orao is an advocacy and policy leader at KMET, a Kisumu-based NGO that promotes health and education services. She says the pandemic may be contributing to the cases.
The fact that people have been locked up in their houses for a long period of time is also something that we attribute to the skyrocketing of these numbers. Mm-hmm. And so the issues are vast, and people are not getting as much income as they used to be, and that multi-sectoral approach when dealing with sexual violence, there's so many causal factors that you need to look at, and poverty, unfortunately, is still one of those. Mm-hmm. And so there's been just a number of things that have led to these numbers increasing. Mm-hmm.
And that has been confirmed by the WHO that the pandemic has actually skyrocketed the numbers of sexual gender-based violence. And it is really sad because the country is also reeling in the same. And I'd like to hear from Joy. What is your experience from where you sit at the Deaf Empowerment Society of Kenya?
Hi, Kevin.
Can you hear us, Anna?
I did not hear the question.
The question was, we are seeing a lot of cases of sexual gender-based violence in the country, especially during this pandemic. What is the experience for those living with special needs?
Kevin.
I think she cannot hear us, and we'll get back to that experience in a moment. Let me bring in Anne. Definitely the pandemic has exacerbated the situation, but what is of concern, and it has come out of the earlier report, is that very few actually think they have the right to go and report, Anne. Okay, we seem to have lost Anna also. So let me bring it back to Roselyne. You talked about FGM, the impacts of the same. SGBV is something else that's also a thorn in the flesh. Definitely not being able to report is making it worse. So what are the measures that can be put in place to ensure more children can report these cases?
Thank you. And I think the first thing is children need to know where they can report and that they can actually report. So the starting point for me would be creating awareness and knowledge among children, including parents and caregivers, that violence first and foremost is wrong. Children should not be experiencing violence. And they should also get the information of where to report if violence happens, how to report, and what to expect. I think listening to children, some of the children who have experienced violence, and like we heard from that clip you just played a few minutes ago, Gladys, is that where violence have happened, nothing has been done. And that's a bit, you know, discouraging among the children. So moving forward as a country, we need to really take action to end violence against children by first and foremost ensuring that whenever it happens, it's reported. And children need to know that first and foremost, they can report violence to a trusted adult. They can report any form of abuse happening to them, to a children's officer. They can report to police. They can report to even NGO partners that are working around them. The key point is provide, give this information of what the children are experiencing to a trusted adult. And in addition, if that's not available, there is a child helpline number managed by the government of Kenya. The toll free, it's children don't pay, it's not charging. The 116 is a number they can call, which then will link the child to a child protection officer who then takes action by reporting the matter to an authority like police. And it shouldn't just end there. The report should go beyond the police to them taking action so that the perpetrator, whoever has violated a child, is punished. And I think the point here is we need to see more cases of child violators being punished in the country. That's the only way we will best end violence on children.
Okay, we hear you, Roselyne, and I'd like to hear from Joy. What is your experience, especially dealing with children with special needs, especially when it comes to sexual gender-based violence?
Now, I see there's a lot of challenge. Children need special with children with special needs. The reason is the children who are being sexually abused, also the parents, they don't encourage them. Also, they tell them to go and do the sex. And the parents use children with special needs so that they can do the business of sexual abuse. And these, they can get some money. This story is very sad. As an outreach officer, I've found stories on the same, which is making me to be more discouraged. And children with special needs have on higher risk on the same. Maybe, for example, they don't have interpreters to report the information. So the community sees it's okay for them to serve, but it's not a norm for them. We have many issues outside there which we cannot reach them, but we are trying to do more survey on the same. We have many more issues. So we have to create more awareness on the same so that we can solve the problem of special needs, children with special needs.
Okay, now on the issue of not being able to report violence at the police stations or just accessing the justice system, which now was, of course, the theme for the Day of the African Child, access to a child-friendly justice system. Is this possible?
As implementing partners, if we as a government actually make deliberate actions or deliberate plans on ensuring that justice is indeed accessible to the children. If you look at it from a survivor's perspective, that's a child who may have undergone any form of violence. Number one, have you empowered that child enough to be able to walk to the nearest police station or local administration or the community gatekeepers and actually make a report of having experienced any of those forms of violence, including sexual violence, which is the most pervasive? So the issues around putting information out there in a manner that that child will be able to understand and know, should I have gone through X, Y, and Z? Do they understand what forms of violence are to enable them to know that in case they do undergo it, that they can walk up to the authorities? Mm-hmm. The second angle in it is, are the authorities aware of the penal code, the Sexual Offences Act, and what their duties are as duty holders, duty bearers, when it comes to reports being made to them? At, for example, the police station level, we've been talking about gender desk units, which are designated desks specifically for handling issues related to gender-based violence and even violence against children. At hospitals, you're supposed to have a designated care provider, service provider, who is able to have the conversation with a child should a child go and report to them as a first point of contact. Have we trained our service providers to acknowledge the evolving capacities of children so that they don't address children as any other adult? They have to take into consideration that a child's brain development is not the same as an adult. So they need to break down information for that child so that when that child does go there and report, they can actually have a conversation and get all the information that they require from the child and then administer to them the clinical management. At police stations, the police officers should be able to communicate with the child in an effective manner enough to be able to give them the help that they seek. Now, if a child perhaps understands what violence is and they've made the report, and yet none of the service providers actually take the matter seriously, then clearly there's a breakdown in terms of reporting. So it's not just about the child. We need to look at our service providers, and it's not just a focus on the health and the police. Mm-hmm. We need to look at teachers. We acknowledge that violence does happen in schools, especially sexual and physical violence is all by peers.
Yes.
We need to empower capacity, build the teachers to be able to be approachable to the children and to be able to refer in case the child does come and report to them. With the children officers at the social welfare sector or ministry, the ones at the community level, again, need to be empowered in a manner that they make it aware to the, they may raise awareness at community level that should any form of violence occur, we are here to help you. We need to stop the culture of being quiet about it and the culture of assuming children would not understand. Children do understand a lot more, especially in this day and age of information. So we need to give the children and treat them as people who can actually report and understand what it is they're saying and give them the services that they require. And as the service providers, we need to be very clear on what happens should a child come to me and report violence. Once we have that sorted out and our referral and linkage pathways as implementing partners, as government service providers, then we won't be seeing what we saw in the report, where you only have around 1 in 10 children out of the 50% who reported any form of violence. Only 1 in 10 was able to actually report and seek the services that they much needed.
Okay, and speaking of which, cases of sexual violence and teen pregnancies have been on the rise since schools closed, and now the Kenya Union of Post-Primary Education Teachers want tougher action taken against the protectors of the children who turn out to be their tormentors. They also want the government to strengthen the systems for child protection as a way of preserving their welfare.
Following reports that indicated that approximately 400,000 teen pregnancies were recorded in the first 3 months since schools were closed, Teachers Union KUPPET wanted the law to come down hard on perpetrators.
The judiciary should also be incentivized to give priority to cases of sexual offenses during this pandemic and to interpret the law correctly.
Education Cabinet Secretary Professor George Magoha has called on parents to keep a sharper eye on their children forced to stay at home by the pandemic. The union now also wants rescue centers established for children to protect them from abuse at home. Meanwhile, 25 human rights organizations are calling on the government to implement the Sexual and Reproductive Health Bill that proposes sex education in schools.
We appeal to the Ministry of Health and the Ministry of Education to finalize, launch, and implement a comprehensive curriculum on sexual and reproductive health and rights, targeting in and out of school adolescents.
We are also asking the government that they make available youth-friendly facilities, because we know the health-seeking behaviors of young people is not the same as the older people. So if we make all these options available, then we are able to also deal with teenage pregnancies. We are able to see young girls making decisions because we know they have a right to access contraceptives.
Religious groups have denounced the bill on grounds that it will amplify sexual immorality in the society. Ruth Sarmui, NTV.
And Wawira, clearly this is something that the country is grappling with, but I wonder, now that the East African Civil Society Organization Forum caters for the region, are there countries that we can probably borrow best practices from?
First, let me begin by saying that it's a problem that that all partner states are going through, or rather are facing. In fact, there's an interagency, multisectoral interagency working group that's working on trying to harmonize some of the responses, approaches that each partner state has in their countries. Mm-hmm. Because of course we have, there are so many laws and policies that are international and regional, and of course the ones that have been made national, but at the same time, the responses are not the same, and some responses seem to work, some responses don't seem to work. So the interagency working group tries to harmonize those responses, and in fact, like two months ago, the EAC formed the regional GBV working group. Of course, it was an immediate response to the rising cases in all the partner states, where all the countries are talking about the rise of, in GBV and violence against children at this time. And it was formed to get to know how our partner states coping. Because, you know, with COVID, we are trying to deal with COVID, and at the same time, there's this shadow pandemic. What are other partner states doing? So at the moment, it's something that the region is trying to harmonize and to get to know what other countries are doing and to share the best practices, because From the last meeting that we had last week, most countries have the regional, the national GBV working groups, where they try to have a rapid response towards the, you know, protection and also response towards gender-based violence and violence against children. But some countries have not really had some of the laws that are specific to GBV, mm-hmm. or even some guidelines that are necessary to assist with the referral, GBV referral pathways that Anne has just talked about. Mm-hmm. So there are some countries that are winning in some parts of the referral pathways, for example, policies, mm-hmm. and there are some that are leading on shelters and safe houses, mm-hmm. Like Uganda. They gave us a good report last week of how they're trying to have a collective approach with both government. They have a collective approach with government and both CSOs in the operation of the shelters. Mm-hmm. Then it comes to the issue of, you know, Kenya and how we keep on talking about the safe houses and the shelters. Mm-hmm. It's still an issue. And speaking about that, we facilitated a survey on shelters and safe houses. And most of the groups of people that need or were trying to access shelters and safe houses were children, followed by who had undergone violence against children, mm-hmm. and then followed by women and girls. Mm-hmm. And you can see that the referral pathways have been well put out, but the struggle is on creating or developing guidelines and actually implementing, mm-hmm. and trying to strengthen those referral pathways, which is a challenge in the region.
Okay, and before I take another short break on Your World, I'd like to hear from Lois Snow. The report indicated that a majority of children say they do not report because they actually do not think that the sexual gender-based violence against them is an abuse or even a problem in the first place. Break that down. How does a child get to a point where they think this is okay?
I think, Gladys, we go back to what I mentioned, that a caregiver of any child represents their world and the reality of their world. So whatever that caregiver does then becomes a reality for that child. And once it becomes a reality for that child, then it becomes a normal until someone maybe introduces another normal, that then that person who introduces that next normal has to be very, very strategic and very aware so that they can convince this child that what is happening to them is not what is supposed to happen to them. Because we have, and I've handled so many cases of children who have been abused for years or for decades with their parents, and by their parents or the caregivers or very close relatives. And what I would like to point out at this point is that we are seeing a bit of less very physically damaging violence, but still emotionally and extremely dangerous forms of violence. And that is where we know our colleagues had brought in that we are no longer having this person, you know, being forcefully physical. They're using means that could be safe, that this child might not be physically so hurt that it can be seen by anyone else. So they have adopted some softer ways of sexual abuse, softer ways of emotional abuse. And then we know for sure that whoever is abusing anybody, whether it's a child or an adult, one of the things that they use is threat. And you know, they threaten and then they close the boundaries and then they make it impossible for them to actually access any outside intervention. Mm-hmm. Now that can happen for a very long time because this person is in control of the child. They are the caregivers, they are the fathers, the parents. And I want to say this, that one of the challenges that any document, any survey, any person that might be wanting to look for a solution, it means because it has everything to do with mental health of the society as we speak. All forms of abuse is a mental issue. And we have not really involved the critical players who are the counselors, psychologists, clinical psychologists into the strategic and very intentional, you know, interventions that are being done. And that is something that we are continually also advocating for.
Okay, and before I take that short break, I hear you are speaking to us even as we asked you that question. How best can we protect our children from violence? We're talking about sexual, emotional, and of course physical violence. McDonald is back again, and he says differentiating violating a child's right and minor punishment while correcting a child's misbehavior rather has been a greater challenge with today's generation. Kindly shed light on that. Lance Don't Lie says, very objective topic about a real issue. Thank you for watching Your World. Another here from Cosmos Magoline, who says, we need civic education on martyrs, childcare to all parents as enshrined in the Children's Act, Universal Declaration of Human Rights, and UN Charter on Children's Rights, Article 12 for UN Charter, for instance, ought to be shared. Very well said, because there are items out there that protect children's rights. And Chico Bosco says children needs protection, or they need protection. Government has failed us on this one big time. Now, the interesting thing is, as much as the state has a part to play, society and you have a part to play in protecting our children. When we come back, there is the face of violence. Some people think violence against children looks a certain way. So, is it discriminatory? We'll answer that question when we come back.
By not having to use multiple products. And you only rinse once. For a laundry soap that can help save you time, water, and money, try Whitewash Extra. Brand Power, helping you buy better.
Breaking news from Molfix. Let's see what they're developing right now.
Molfix pants with anatomic fit technology. New Molfix pants, an invention from babies for babies.
You should also try Molfix.
And more Christian music only on Angaza Music. Get Angaza Music for 10 shillings daily plus 50 MB data bundle. Dial *544#, then select option 6 on your Safaricom line. Angaza Music. Baraka Mkono.
When we moved from analog to digital, we took the opportunity to share our talanta. And the rise of local radio represented our voices mtaani. New ICT and educational platforms are going to make sure that no one is left behind.
Communications Authority of Kenya, opening your world.
It is your world. My name is Gladys Gachanja. Let's look at the other world. And in the mountain villages of the province of Cuneo, a camper van turns into a traveling cinema to bring people the magic of the big screen. The idea was conceived around 5 years ago by Fabio Gionotti and his wife, who decided to repurpose their 40-year-old camper. With little to do in remote parts of Cuneo, the camper brings people together to watch movies under the stars. We started very quietly over 5 years ago with a few people and places, and slowly over the years the thing started to work out, and more people have asked us to do so. This year with COVID, we've had a boom, said the campers. The silver lining in this pandemic right there. Now, Mongolia's annual Nadam Sporting Festival kicked off Saturday without a live audience for the first time in its 800-year history as COVID-19 fears gripped the Central Asian country. Athletes showed off the three manly skills of horsemanship, archery, and wrestling in a ranch, dressed in traditional Zudog Shudog wrestling suits and deal tunics. But the two-day festival, which usually attracts tens of thousands of onlookers and street vendors, permits only a handful of guests, including top politicians this year, with ordinary citizens barred by police from entering the venue under crowd control measures intended to prevent the spread of the coronavirus. Mongolians are instead encouraged to watch the games on live broadcasts. Elsewhere, it started out as three friends playing on the balcony, bringing a little music to life under Spain's lockdown with a guitar and a bucket as a drum. But 2 months, 27 songs and 400,000 Instagram followers later, the stay-homers, as the band is called, have signed a contract with Sony and will release an album later in the year. Guilherme Balto, a member of the band, says, "If we had been told this would happen, we wouldn't have believed it, not even in a 100 lives. It was unthinkable to us. It's completely unreal." Well, well done to them. I want to see my friend. I want to walk the streets again, again, again. Let's enjoy this combination. I gotta be patient. Let's enjoy this combination. Back in Africa, women and rights groups in Maiduguri in northeastern Nigeria hold a march to protest against rape. Demonstrators sing songs of protest and carry signs reading Say No to Rape and Believe and Support Survivors. According to the United Nations Children Agency UNICEF, 1 in 4 Nigerian women are sexually abused before they turn 18, and the majority of cases of sexual abuse in the country are not prosecuted. Now, this is the reality. The monstrous acts of those who will not take no for an answer are ruining lives across the country. But they rarely come as brutal as they did for one woman from Baringo.
In Kasiala village, Baringo South, we find Cherono, not her real name. Last December, Cherono was on her way home from casual labor, her four-month-old baby in hand, when a male stranger accosted her. For at least more than half an hour, she was pinned down, her tormentor taking painful rounds of brutal gratification from her. She lay there helplessly, too weak to even feel the baby's pulse. It wasn't until a herder chasing his flock home spotted her, by which time her baby was long gone. Back home and without medical or psychosocial support, Cherono's troubles would soon multiply. Her husband of years left her. A local women's rights group is pursuing legal recourse for Cherono, but she is not alone. There have been over 20 rape cases here this year alone, they say.
Indigenous women and all women in maybe rural areas are suffering a lot in silence. That lady lost her child in the process of being raped. We've been trying to reach out on various government bodies, including even NGOs, on how best she can be helped to maybe fight for her rights to be recognized.
Until proper institutions and more stringent laws are put in place, sex predators will stay on the prowl.
Depending on the individual facts of each case, upon application by the DPP, the courts will be available to give early hearing dates and hear those matters as quickly as possible.
Still, the stigma associated with sexual violence makes justice a mirage for many victims.
A heart-wrenching report there by Bridget Sungana, but the reality for so many survivors of sexual gender-based violence. Let me bring in Joy in this conversation. Joy, for those that are living with special needs, considering we live in a society where stigma is rife when it comes to SGBV, how do you support them? Because psychosocial support is paramount.
I see stigma is on a higher or effect, and it has a lot of effect to children with special needs, because most of the children will see that their parents don't like them and they feel a lot of pain on the same. So the child's mind changes and psychologically they are affected. So they become more stressed, and at the same time, they feel they are not comfortable living with their parents. So when they are growing, they know that their parents doesn't care for them. So even their parents, they don't know how to cater for those kids with special needs. So they prefer going to stay with a friend or a relative, maybe, for example, an uncle, because of stigma. Or they prefer staying outside, maybe to become street children outside there, because they don't have hope in life. So when we're talking about these children, the problem starts from where? Home. These children with special needs, they have a lot of challenges because of stigma. They are not cared for, nobody can help them, nobody knows their needs. So they lose their hope, they lose hope. I see many children who are outside there, and their children with special needs, they are begging outside in the streets. And yes, they have home, but the parents are the problems. So they run away from home because of that. So the parents should care for children's special needs very well. For example, you hear a story from me. My parents cared for me very well, and I copy the same to do. So the parents should copy the same. They should not neglect these children or special needs, because it brings a lot of effects to them.
Okay, now let me pose this question to Anne. With your work at the LVCT Health, when it comes to the impact, not only the physical impact of SGBV, there is the HIV impact of this. Talk about that.
So at LVCT Health, we were primarily known for offering HIV voluntary counseling and testing, but now we also spread our scope of work to include addressing gender-based violence at community and facility level. At community, more in terms of prevention of the gender-based violence, and at facility level, in terms of the medical response for all those people who are able to reach our facilities and indeed report that they've undergone violence. All our service providers, and we cover around 28 counties in Kenya, all our service providers have been well trained, and they're very aware that in cases of especially sexual violence that is reported within 72 hours, there needs to be a HIV test that is done just to ensure that the survivor may not have been infected by the perpetrator, because nobody knows the status of the perpetrator. Beyond the HIV testing and counseling, which again is done by an accredited counselor, we also do STI, sexually transmitted infection screening, and prophylaxis, because again, we do not know what the perpetrator may have had, but we are handling the survivor who's reported the sexual violence case. We also offer emergency contraceptive pill, and we also do trauma counseling. We don't take it for granted that the experience that the survivor may have undergone, especially a child, will be very traumatic on them, as has been said. So you need to address their mental state at that point in a manner that is ethical and is right for the child. So what we do, and again, what we've trained all our service providers, is to offer what we call LIVES, first line support for psychological first aid, where we listen to the survivor very keenly, we inquire about their needs, we validate what they're saying. There's a lot of victim blaming going on out there in the community. And by the time the child is reaching the facility, that's the last thing that they want to undergo, or being re-traumatized and being made to seem like it's their fault that they've undergone sexual violence. It's never their fault, and nobody can ever place themselves in such a situation. So we need to validate as counselors, we validate what it is that they're saying, and then we enhance the support that they have, or enhance their safety. Again, we don't take it for granted that the perpetrator might be within close proximity. So safety is a very key thing. We don't want them coming to report to us, and then they're placed in additional risk by going out there. And the final thing that we do as part of the psychological first aid that we give is to give them support and refer to them appropriately. What we do at LVCT, our expertise is mainly in the health component, the medical response that we give them. So as rightly mentioned, the HIV test, the STI screening, and the emergency contraceptive pill. But we have other people and the first line support, but we have other service providers who we work very closely. In case we see that the child does need advanced psychological first aid, we're able to refer to facilities where we have ascertained that they're able to accept the child, what we call a warm referral, that they will be able to accept the child and give them the psychological assessment over 5 sessions or more that the child may be required to be able to overcome the trauma that they have gone through. But we're able to take care of the medical component of the needs of that child, the immediate needs of that child.
Okay, and Roslyn, there was a mention of economic impact of violence against children. Now, explain this to us.
Violence against children affects the well-being of the children all around. You know, this child, if it's sexual violence, I think the country has been talking about the increased numbers of teenage pregnancy. What it means is once this child gets pregnant, there are no chances of engaging into other development aspects, particularly education, for instance. And even nutrition is affected. Most of these children will never then get involved in economic productive activities because their life somehow is cut short. Not only on sexual violence, physical violence, we've looked at the impact of physical violence. When children end up with injuries, some have even ended up with death in extreme cases of violence. This clearly has a negative impact on productivity and negative impact on the national economy of a country. Mm-hmm. So the faster we begin to address ending violence on children, the more we are likely to achieve our economic goals, even as a country.
Okay, and while you are speaking about that, maybe you can touch on the importance of a campaign that was also launched, the Spot It, Stop It campaign, because as Anne was saying, looking at the prevention of the same is also critical.
Yes, Gladys, the Spot It, Stop It campaign, it's an end violence, it's a national end violence campaign among children. And the idea is, as we've said in this discussion, we've had continuous increase between the 2010 VAC survey and now the 2019 VAC survey report. Violence on children has continued. So therefore, it's very important for a country like Kenya to prevent violence from happening in the first place. And why it's happening is because we can see most of the institutions and the people who needed to protect children are actually not acting. So therefore, we have so much violence happening against children. So first and foremost, the campaign provides information, creates awareness and information on what violence against children is. Mm-hmm. Also points out the various perpetrators, because children need to know they continue in their innocence to trust people who end up violating them. So the campaign provides information that empowers children to know these people they trust can also turn against them and violate them. The Spot It, Stop It campaign also provides information on where to report violence and empowers especially the younger children at ECD to lower primary level to recognize violence, because children play innocently. A lot of times you'll find grown-ups, if it comes to, for example, sexual abuse, you get grown-ups who get to touching their private parts. Mm-hmm. So there has to be a deliberate effort to make children understand this is a form of abuse. If it's happening to them or their friends, they need to report, and they need to know who to report to and where to report. So the Spot It, Stop It, it's really a campaign to end violence on children that is led by the government of Kenya, other partners, and UNICEF to ensure that information is provided. And not only the information, but also there's an effort to empower children and communities to be able to prevent, first of all, violence from happening. And when it happens, mm-hmm. that's why we are saying, if any form of violence against children happens, be it sexual, be it physical, mm-hmm. be it emotional, or even the child online abuse, children need to spot it. The parents and caregivers need to spot it. All the duty bearers need to spot it and stop it.
Okay. And even as we wind up this conversation, I'll start with you, Wawira, in a very, very brief manner. Let us know how, as a society, we can ensure that we protect our children better.
I'll speak from both national and regional level.
Yes.
Noting some of the issues that need to be prioritized, yeah? And looking at it from the point of laws and policies, because it's what we do most on issues of laws and policies. We need to start first by prioritizing and pushing for the completion and also implementation of the laws and policies, mm-hmm. and the completion of the ones that are currently pending, like the child trafficking bill, the reviewing of the child policy. Mm-hmm. The child trafficking bill is very, very important because for us as a region, there's a lot of child trafficking issues that are currently happening, not even just currently, have been happening. Mm-hmm. And as the years have gone by, it has increased. The child trafficking has increased. And just look at it from the point of us not knowing that it can happen within the country and also across the borders. Mm-hmm. So it's an issue that needs to be addressed because that's a form of violence as well. So some of the pending bills and policies need to be prioritized. The Sexual Offences Act has been is undergoing amendments to complement the already existing laws and policies. So this is from the point of the state. And then yeah. the community, looking at it from the point of social norms, normalization of some things, what we have talked about FGM, what we have talked about the societal rules and beliefs that this is not violence and this should happen or is supposed to happen, and also the community taking making use of the already existing community structures like the community policing structures and enhancing reporting and advocacy. Mm-hmm. I think that would be my last words on making use of what's already existing, mm-hmm. and pushing for implementation of the laws, because you have very good laws, and also going further to enhancing and strengthening all the referral pathways. Because if there's a breakage at one point, if we don't have shelters, if the health services are not accessible, yes. if we have restrictions at one point, if you go to the police and you're taken back, it has to be a clean, smooth mm-hmm. referral pathway for us to protect.
Very well said. Let me bring in Joy Kanana. Even as we make ending violence against children a reality, what would you like to say, especially when we are considering children living with special needs?
Okay, it is true. The government has a lot of plans, goals, and they have a lot of promises they have made. Maybe, for example, the SDGs, Sustainable Development Goals. So the government has all these in place so that they can stop violence in any form. But the government doesn't have any system which is friendly to people with disability. For example, we don't have interpreters who can create awareness on the same about their needs. So the government should have and have close, friendly system which can merge with people with special needs. And I don't see it there.
Okay, well noted. And we finish off with Lois Noor. You are the counseling psychologist. We have said the health impact of any form of violence on children is immense. What should society keep in mind even as we nurture these children?
I think for me, Gladys, thank you. The word for me is shelter, the reporting. Recognizing and reporting violence. anything that would empower anyone to recognize and report would be the best way forward. And that means that we need to move a little bit away from the child and even empower a neighbor, empower a friend, empower a passerby to be able to just recognize and find a place for reporting. And I look at the LVCT model, if it could be intensified and be present even in the 47 counties, I think that was the best thing. But lastly, like I think my colleague said, there are certain laws that have to be put in place mm-hmm. so that certain actions are possible. And one of them is the counselors and psychologists bill that is, the law that is still pending implementation so that we can have empowered counselors in every county and begin to work the way they should be. Thank you.
Thank you, ladies. Lois Noor, their counseling psychologist, Rosalind Mutemi-Wanga, who is the communication for development specialist at the UNICEF Kenya, and Gunjiri, senior technical advisor at the gender-based violence department at the LVCT Health, and Joy Kanana, Deaf Outreach Officer at the Deaf Empowerment Society of Kenya, based in Embu, Obeira Nyaga, National Coordinator, East Africa Civil Society Organizations Forum, and of course, our interpreter of the day, who was Anna Mwenesi. Ladies, thank you for joining me on this really pertinent conversation, even as we found out how we can better safeguard the rights of our children. Tomorrow is another day. Thank you for staying with Your World. Do take care. Thank you.